गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन. वी आर नाउ वेटिंग फॉर अ कपल ऑफ मिनट्स फॉर ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स टू जॉइन इन. एंड टुडे वी हैव अ वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग टॉपिक फॉर आवर वेबिनार, डीमिस्टिफाइंग क्रिटिकल प्रोविजंस ऑफ द इंसॉल्वेंसी एंड बैंकरप्सी कोड. सो लेट अस वेट फॉर कपल ऑफ मिनट्स, एंड इन द मीन टाइम आई जस्ट लाइक टू इन्फॉर्म द पार्टिसिपेंट्स that they can put in their questions, whatever are their queries and all, in the chat box. And during the course of the webinar, we'll try addressing the issues. And at the end of the webinar, we shall have our Q&A for the last 15 minutes or so, wherein we'll take the questions of the participants and try addressing the issues which the participants feel are relevant in today's day and context. And I think the timing of our webinar has coincided with the amendment ordinance, which was introduced yesterday. So personally, at least I am looking forward to some very insightful discussion on the ordinance. Also, we have the benefit of having Honorable Member Mr. VP Singh with us, and we are really greatly honored, sir, that you could take out time for the webinar and help us understand some important parts of the code, which all of us are struggling to deal with, trying to understand. And Mr. Dheer is also there. He'll be also giving his view on the ordinance and other issues. But we are looking forward to an interactive session with all of the participants, with all of us. And in a couple of minutes' time, I'm just waiting for some more people to join in. And we can then probably go ahead and try understanding how IBC will shape up in the post-COVID-19 era, because COVID-19 in our understanding has impacted everyone. So we need to see and analyze how various stakeholders, which will be the borrowers, the creditors, the employees, the workmen, everyone will deal in this post-COVID era, how our judiciary will come forward and tackle this issue, which is very peculiar, which has just put all of us out of our comfort zone. And we are now trying to understand and analyze how, in the best possible way, we can proceed with all these things. So all these and many more issues, as we'll be discussing and going ahead, we'll look forward to the inputs of my esteemed panel and consider what to accordingly take in the best possible approach. So now it's 11:30. So I'll briefly introduce my esteemed panel, who definitely don't need an introduction. We have Honorable Member Mr. Shri Vijay Pratap Singh with us. Sir, we are greatly honored to have you. Mr. Vijay Pratap Singh is a science graduate and a law graduate from the Allahabad University. He got selected in Uttar Pradesh Judicial Services in 1977 batch at a very young age of 23 years. Thereafter, he has remained at different positions at district judge as a chief judicial magistrate, chief judge senior division. He got promoted and selected in the higher judicial services with effect from 23rd of June 1999, and has held the post of additional district and sessions judge in Aligarh, Kanpur. Thereafter, he also worked as an additional district and sessions judge, district judge in Mathura. He's also been the president of the Uttar Pradesh Judicial Services Association and was elected as a secretary of general of All India Judges Association. Sir has also been the chairman of Permanent Lok Adalat Meerut, and thereafter he also joined as the chairman of Permanent Lok Adalat at Ghaziabad. Pursuant to his resignation, he joined the National Company Law Tribunal as a member judicial with effect from 2nd of June 2015. Sir has been the member of the Kolkata bench, the judicial member of the Kolkata bench of NCLT, Allahabad bench and the Mumbai bench, and is now the member technical of the Honorable National Company Law Appellate Tribunal. Sir, we thank you once again for being with us. Joining Honorable Member Vijay Pratap Singh is Mr. Alok Dheer. Mr. Alok Dhir is a qualified chartered accountant and a lawyer and has been in practice since 1983. He is also an insolvency professional and specializes in corporate and financial restructuring. Mr. Dhir is the managing partner of Dhir and Dhir Associates, which is one of the leading insolvency law firms in India. He is a member of the committee, which was set up by the Government of India for formulating regulations for individual insolvency, and has also been appointed by Indian Institute of Corporate Affairs on the panel of experts. Mr. Dhir is a member of the Executive Board and Treasurer of Insol India. He has been consistently recognized as a leading lawyer for restructuring and insolvency in India by Legal 500, Chambers and Partners, Asia Law Profile, ILNFR, etc., and has been also the star performer for Corporate Restructuring Firm of the Year 2019, Restructuring and Insolvency Law Firm of the Year 2019. We welcome you, Mr. Dhir. So now I'll first and foremost, because of the benefit of the timing of the webinar, as I was saying, would first seek Honorable Member Vijay Pratap Singh's view on the amendment ordinance which came in yesterday night. So we'll first like to understand from you, how do you view this amendment? The amendment says the date of defaults from 25th of March 2020 shall not entitle any initiation of proceedings on the court. What are your opening remarks on this, sir?
Good morning to all of you. First of all, I would like to thank you all that you have invited me on this webinar. Before starting this webinar, I would like to ask how you fixed the date yesterday, ordinance was issued, and you and today you have done this.
That is why I'm saying, sir, it's coincided and I'm grateful for that.
You are aware of this fact that we have to ordinance is going to be. And then I saw the ordinance. This is section 10A. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are audible.
Section 10A has been introduced. Section 10A. Which provides any default which is committed after 25th March onward, then there shall be the suspension of all the proceedings in section 7, 9, section 8, 9, 10, everything. But the question is, there are certain questions if the default occurred before then, that. And ordinance has clarified for that also. If the default occurred before 25th March, then there is a provision that then it will have no effect and the proceeding will go on. Only this protects, Section 10A protects those defaults which are committed during this pandemic period, when the entire Suppose a default occurred, default of threshold limit, suppose 1 crore, default of more than 1 crore rupees occurred before 25th March, then the proceeding will go on as usual. It can be filed even during this period. Fresh proceeding can be filed because ordinance is very much clear. Position has been made clear that what will amount to material, it is not a blanket ban of all the proceedings, blanket suspension of proceedings, but our window is open for those defaults which occurred prior to 25th March, and up to threshold mark, it meets the threshold mark. Then there is no ban on that, and that proceeding can be filed. Another section has been introduced. An explanation is also given in this regarding explanation is given for removal of doubts. It is given that provisions are, it has not left anything to be defined whether default will, the proceeding will await or not. If the default occurred prior to 25th March, it will have no effect. Section 10A will have no effect. Similarly, another provision has been added in this. Section 66, they say that notwithstanding anything contained in this section, no application shall be filed by resolution to petitioner under subsection 2 in respect of such default, against which intimation of corporate insolvency resolution process is suspended as per section 10A. But the question arises, if any proceeding has been made in section, any action has been found under in violation of section 66, then, and this has happened during this period, then whether then no action can be taken? This question arises, we have to give a thought on it. If the procedure, anything that happens during this period, during pandemic after 25th March, and 10A applies to that, and it is also fit, it meets the requirement of section 66 also, that whether RP can file the proceeding or not. Anyhow, ordinance says that any proceeding in this cannot be filed. And anyhow, threshold limit has already been increased. We all know that threshold limit has been increased, and it is section from 1 lakh to 1 lakh to 1 crore. It is 100 times increase in the threshold limit. Only 100 times increase, it will have a long 100 time increase. It will have very much impact on most of the operational sector cases, because if we collect the data up to December 2019, we found that about 21,196 cases were filed up to December 2019, and out of that 9,000 cases were decided out of court in the pre-admission stage. See, if the 9,000 cases, these all are mostly belonging to operational sectors. Now the threshold limit has been increased. It will have impact on this. These are the incidental proceedings. See, if it is pre-admission, if it is decided, then certainly so many, there was here in among the borrowers, if you have taken, they have taken the loan, they have to repay that. That's why matter is, if the case is filed, matters are being settled. But now there is blanket ban, there is ban of one year. Then certainly operational sector may suffer for some time during this period. After all, aim of the government is to revive the economy, or revive the industries. But certainly it is a condition where not only in India, everywhere insolvency law has been amended. In US, it has been amended, US, Australia, in most of the countries it has been amended, not only in India. And threshold limit has been increased. But anyhow, operational sector may suffer for some time, and it will have impact on their cases also.
Thank you, sir. Honorable Member Mr. V.P. Singh has given us some of the very key elements of the ordinance, and sir has rightly pointed out that all these, the suspension proceeding are futuristic in nature, in the sense that the cutoff date has been given as 25th of March 2020 in the ordinance that was released yesterday. And it is only defaults with effect from 25th of March 2020 that no proceedings under Section 7, 9 and 10 of the code can be initiated. I'll now like to go to Mr. Dheer and understand what is his take on this amendment. And sir had pointed out certain critical issues, such as also suspension of Section 66, how the element of fraud and all will now be looked into, and the timing of the particular ordinance. And what is Mr. Dheer's view on this ordinance and how he views it, especially as regards the operational creditors, what was pointed out by the Honorable Member, that they may somehow stand to suffer to some extent, if I may use the words. Mr. Dheer.
Thanks, Varsha, and thank you, Singh sir. I think a very good analysis dealing with every aspect of the ordinance which has come is already, you have already given it for the benefit of all the participants. But I may like to put a lawyer's perspective to it. And as we all understand, the lawyers try to find where the problems are and ultimately it will fall upon you, Mr. Singh, to ultimately decide these and say what is the correct interpretation of the ordinance. I think the two critical issues where already a debate is going on in some WhatsApp groups relating to the ordinance, and I'll just deal with those. The first issue is, what is the meaning of 10A? The section as it reads is, notwithstanding anything contained in section 7, 9 and 10, no application for initiation of the corporate insolvency resolution process of a corporate debtor shall be filed for any default arising on or after 25th March 20 for a period of 6 months or such further period not exceeding 1 year from such date as may be notified. Now, one of the issues of controversy is that what is the meaning of such date and what is the meaning of the word as may be notified? Because there is a date which is already given there, which is 25th of March 20. If 25th of March 20 was the date, which was the said date, then the question of notification of a further date did not arise. But I think the correct interpretation of this section is by reading it in parts. First is, default arising on or after 25th March 20 for a period of 6 months is one part. Therefore, it is during this period that there is suspension. However, it is open to the government to notify any such further date that they may want, which is up to a period of 1 year. So it could be either between 25th March for a period of 6 months, or it could be from 25th March to such date as the government may notify, which in any case has to be for a period of 1 year. So that may be the correct interpretation. That may be the purposeful interpretation for this particular provision. The problem is further compounded by the proviso which has been added. Now, the proviso says that provided that no application shall ever be filed for initiation of corporate insolvency resolution process of a corporate debtor for the said default occurring during the said period. Now, while we all understand that during the COVID period, every business is facing pressures, and we do not want that because of this unprecedented event, lots of companies should go into CIRP or into liquidation. Therefore, what was necessary was that there was required to be a suspension of these proceedings for a point of time. However, to say that if the default has occurred during this period, no petition, no application will ever be filed in future is a little too harsh insofar as the rights of the creditors are concerned. Now, let me give you an example, because the date of default is what is relevant for the purpose of deciding this. Swiss Ribbons has also said it, Supreme Court has said it in so many ways and means now. Limitation periods are also starting from those dates. Now, if we say that the default occurs, there is an NCD, because every financial transaction has a particular date which is called the due. Now, let us say if an NCD is issued, it's a period, it's a 3-year NCD, which is ending on a specific date between 25th March and for the period of 6 months. If the entire NCD falls due on that date, obviously the default occurs during this period. Then to say that it will never be able to utilize the benefit of IBC, even after the period of, if I may say, suspension of 6 months or 1 year is over, I think it will be a little unfair on the creditor, because he will never be able to invoke. Other complications will arise where there are multiple dates on which defaults are occurring. So some defaults have occurred prior to 25th March, which means, let us say, monthly payments are to be made. Some payments have fallen prior to 25th March, some payments will fall post 25th March. So if we are to say that any payment which is following post 25th March cannot become the basis for initiation at all, the question will arise as to what is the quantum of claim that a person will be entitled to raise. Is it to say that a claim can be raised insofar as the debt is concerned, even if it has fallen due during the period from 25th March? But only the initiation is barred. So these are complications which will arise for the purpose of interpretation of section 10A. Now, Mr. Singh has very rightly pointed out that the impact of this will be harsh on operational creditors and MSMEs. In fact, he tied up the issue of the threshold of 1 lakh to 1 crore and also the impact of these suspensions. Now, the joint impact of these suspensions, particularly on the MSME sector and the operational creditors, is again going to be very strong and will be felt, and the impact of this will be very, very harsh. The MSMEs and operational creditors typically did not have dues which were exceeding 1 crore. So by one single stroke, and which is actually the notification which came on 24th of March 20, the threshold was raised from 1 lakh to 1 crore. So any entity, any operational creditor or financial creditor for that matter, if his dues are more than, are less than 1 crore, will not be able to avail of this particular provision of law. And the experience from a lawyer point of view has been that this particular IBC has been utilized extensively by the operational creditors. Operational creditors had never had an opportunity to approach a forum in a time-bound manner to obtain relief with respect to their dues. They have a lot of provisions of law, including MSME. There is a provision that you can go to the association. There are so many provisions being made for MSMEs to recover their dues. But the most efficacious remedy was IBC. Large number of cases were filed by the operational creditors. Many of those cases, in fact, a majority of those cases got settled. The MSME sector, the small, if I may say, creditors, operational creditors, financial creditors could get relief, could recover their monies because of the mechanism of the IBC. Unfortunately, because of the twin impact of between 1 lakh and 1 crore, the past cases also they will not be able to bring. And the impact of starting from 25th March for a period of 6 months to 1 year, again, they will be helpless. So I think this will take its toll on the vulnerable section of financial creditors and operational creditors who will not be able to avail this limit, this particular remedy. While, therefore, we have to balance the conveniences. While the conveniences are balanced against the entities who are suffering because of COVID, at the same time, we should not lose track of the fact that this is a beneficial legislation. It was put in play for the purpose of benefiting large sections of operational and financial creditors, and a significant section of these people should not be rendered remedy-less because of these twin modifications, amendments, changes to the IBC.
Thank you, Mr. Deer. So I understand that these amendments, both from the view of the bar and the bench, is a mixed bag, and maybe with time we'll get to understand how this entire journey unfolds now. So this COVID-19 pandemic has also thrown us to a new world, at least for us as lawyers, as we have now been quite regular in virtual hearings. The judiciary has been very quick. They have adapted themselves to the ongoing situations, and just to ensure that there is access to the litigants, came up with the concept of virtual hearings. And all the tribunals, in fact, the tribunals established under the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, that is National Company Law Tribunal, and the Honorable Appellate Authority has also taken cognizance of the virtual hearings. And are regularly taking up matters to address the issues which are coming before the litigants. I'd like to ask Honorable Member Mr. V.P. Singh that in his experience or in his view, how he visualizes the future of virtual hearings, are the issues, the concerns of the litigants and everybody balanced in the virtual hearings which the Honorable Appellate Tribunal has taken up, and they are trying to give dispensation of justice to all the stakeholders. Honorable Member, if I may ask you, sir, to just address on this issue.
Yes. See, virtual hearing is just started, and I think from top court, Honorable Supreme Court, High Court, every court is doing the virtual hearing actually. And it is just in this time, situation is very great. And regular hearing is not possible. Yesterday, you have heard that three high court judges got infection due to hearing in court. Everywhere, nobody can say that safety is the main concern. And virtual hearing has just started. But anyhow, whatever may be the situation, it creates opportunity also. See, this is the situation, this is the transition time when we have to adopt this system. You can remember when there was a time when there was typewriter was given and everybody was having typewriter and typewriter was being used. I can give an illustration. But there was a steno of mine. At that time, I was a civil judge and my steno was there and he was a very good typist. When computer was provided, then he said, sir, I am leaving the job. I am not perfect in computer typing. So I am leaving the job. Then I persuaded him, Yes, no, no, you join, you remain here, we will help you, and anyhow, now you cannot imagine that anybody can depend on that type of typewriter. So this is a phase where we all have to adopt. If anybody has not adopted, he has to change himself. Whatever may be, everything, suppose virtual hearing is going on. Every case cannot be decided through virtual hearing. It's true. But most of the cases can be decided through virtual hearing. There are many advantages in virtual hearing. Suppose you have a case in Madras, you have a case in Calcutta, you have a case in Bombay. There is no need of going everywhere. From here, you can argue everywhere. It is most beneficial for the young generation. Yes. Young generation lads who are hesitant in arguing in court, they get an opportunity and they can prepare and they can argue from their chamber very well. So if they adopt this practice, then certainly they will adopt this device and they will adopt the system, then certainly they can be very successful and there can be mixed hearing in future. Most of the cases can be heard through virtual hearing as well as regular hearing can also be made. If the case is such where regular hearing is essential, then certainly court has every power and the argument will be made. Nobody can be compelled to only virtual hearing we are going. It is, time being, it has been started and it is a testing phase. We are seeing if it is successful, then certainly most of the cases can be decided through virtual hearing, and rest of the cases where we don't get the consent, then certainly regular hearing can be made. But after this transition phase, everybody will like to be part of this. See, everything will be on record. Suppose it is pleadings are, all the things are scanned everywhere. It's very easy to write the judgment, it will be very easy to see the judgment, court proceeding. One person in Delhi can appear everywhere in every court without going there. Certainly, it is a cost saving also. The situation, I think, everybody should adopt this without any hesitation.
Thank you, sir. I think so. Sir has very nicely put it and explained to us by saying that this is an opportunity in itself. And as lawyers, we are always on a lookout for an opportunity. So just a quick take of Mr. Dheer on virtual hearings is that as a practicing counsel, how do you feel the virtual hearings are panning out? And this opportunity was what sir was trying to explain, that sitting in Delhi, probably you can do matters all over India. How do you view this in your personal opinion, Mr. Dheer?
Again, to give a lawyer's perspective to this, firstly, I would say that the march of technology is irreversible. And as Mr. Singh very rightly took us from the time when we used to all work in typewriters. And I must say, Mr. Singh, I also come from the same time when I started my career, typewriters was the only thing. And the first change that happened in technology was the electronic typewriters and then the computers. And then we have reached a stage today, as very rightly pointed out by Mr. Singh, that we are conducting virtual hearings, which we had possibly even 5 years back had never even conceived in our mind. Even though processes had started, we had started seeing that in other parts of the world, evidences had started getting collected, arbitration proceedings had started proceeding on the basis of virtual hearings and video conferencing. But the opportunity has provided itself to us during the COVID times. And that is to ensure that the legal system in this country starts coming up of age and starts matching up to the technological developments which are taking place in the rest of the world. And we may start with this. We have started with this. In some sense, there is talk of about 20 to 40% of the matters being conducted by virtual hearings nowadays. It will now be there to stay. While we will continue to have personal hearings, the inhibitions that people had with respect to virtual hearings will now go away. And it is quite possible that people will start adapting to these and routine issues, which are in the nature of evidences or hearings before registrars, where often critical issues, critical questions of law are not to be debated or discussed. may be decided by way of virtual hearings, which will be efficient, which will be fast, and which will be more professional approach with respect to this. So I would say that these are here to stay. Having said that, we are facing, and I must again compliment the entire judicial system from insofar as IBC is concerned, NCLT, NCLAT, even up to the Supreme Court, matters are being decided. And during this period of COVID, because of the benefit of virtual hearings, so many matters have decided, even admissions have taken place, interim orders are being passed. So the deprivation, depriving the country of the judicial intervention because of the COVID has not happened. The entire legal system has geared itself up to deliver justice to people wherever it was necessary. And I think that is something that we have to really pat ourselves on the back. And I think we have to thank the judicial system. And Mr. Singh, I can thank you because you have yourself been participating in many of these virtual hearings and dispensing justice to people who are in need of this. However, again, from a legal perspective, I must point out that there is a large number of our brethren as lawyers who do not have complete access or who have not completely adapted themselves to virtual hearing. And there is a very large section of the lawyers who have not been able to avail themselves of this beneficial technological development. I think my suggestion to them is that they should try to reskill themselves, they should try to train themselves, and they should try to ensure that there is availability of the process. I, at this point of time, frankly, any virtual hearing can be had from an iPhone or from a phone or a computer, or even there are certain centers where you can go and conduct yourself. So the accessibility has come to the level where everybody can avail. It's a question of reskilling oneself, and it is a question of adapting, and it is to ensure that we are able to utilize the technology and not become a victim to it and not have an attitude in our minds which says that this is something we cannot learn. As the stenographer, which Mr. V.P. Singh has pointed out, that he said he does not know how to work a computer and therefore he wanted to resign. And I can only say that if they learn the technology, they will be able to utilize it more effectively and efficiently for the benefit of the entire legal community and the litigants in the country.
Thank you, Mr. Dheer. So we all understand that the learning curve is always a curve on which we have to keep on moving. So as of now, virtual hearings, in future, we'll proceed further and try imbibe technology to ensure that judiciary, which is one of our major pillars, is always there to help us, support us, guide us. Now, coming back to the ordinance, which was promulgated yesterday, the ordinance, if I may read, states that this particular ordinance has been introduced also in the background that as on date, it may be difficult to find adequate number of resolution applicants to rescue the corporate person who may default in discharge of their debt obligation. So this brings me to my next issue of the aspect of force majeure in the pending resolution plans, in the pending CIRPs, as well as in the pending plans which are pending implementation, if I may use the word, having been approved by the adjudicating authorities, the plans are ripe for implementation. However, this ongoing pandemic of COVID-19 has created a very peculiar situation. And let us try understanding the concept of force majeure and whether force majeure as a concept can be made applicable to an approved resolution plan. So first, I'd like to ask Honorable Member Mr. V.P. Singh that what is his take on this concept of force majeure, and do you feel resolution applicants shall be flooding the courts and coming up and saying that, look, because of the COVID-19 pandemic, we are not in a position to implement the approved resolution plans and the plans should be accordingly be hit by the doctrine of force majeure. So can you please guide us on this issue?
Yes, Ms. Banerjee, you have rightly pointed out. We have read the notification, government notification, and it mentions why this ordinance has been brought. So it is specific that pandemic has impacted business, financial markets, and economy all over the world, including India, and created uncertainty and stress for business, for reasons beyond their control. And whereas it is difficult to find out adequate number of resolution applicants to rescue the corporate persons who may default in discharge of their debt obligation. Everything is discussed, but what the government has legislation, what is their legislation? See, what is, if there is a problem, force measure is discussed in this. But government has only 10A has been introduced in the certain legislation. Then nothing has been done only for after considering all these things, legislation only there is only 10A has been introduced, and which regards suspension of Article 7, Section 7, 9, and 10. Regarding resolution plan, there is no any relief, no any mention anywhere. See, before entering into this issue, we have to observe whether post measure is any part of a contract in an approved resolution plan. See, in most of the contracts nowadays, post measure remains a clause. But everybody has to see whether this post measure is a part of the resolution plan. It has been approved. If it is not approved, then question doesn't arise. Whatever is the difficulty, certain difficulties are there, and so many things have become impossible nowadays to how it can be done. Time limit can be extended, but it all depends on case to case basis. A regulation professional has to report, and the adjudicating authority has to decide what are the circumstances, what the situation has been created. So in this situation, certain if there is any modification is needed, he can report it to the adjudicating authority. Then, but as per rules and regulations, the adjudicating authority will decide anyhow. And there is no legislative provision to ease out everything in the, regarding post measure resolution plan is approved or not approved. Then anybody cannot back out from the approved resolution plan. I just suppose this is permitted, then all the resolution plan everybody will want to exit, because the conditions which were prevailing before 25th March is not the same, and probably it cannot be the same in the within 2 years. Then certainly it will have effect. All the cases will be, most of the resolution plan will fail. So anyhow, time will tell. Whatever, till now no legislation. Government has not given any relief regarding post measure. Only relief is given regarding suspension of Section 7, 9, 10, and that is not a clear cut suspension. If the default has been committed prior to 25th March, then during this period, a petition can be filed. There is no bar for that, and a petition can be admitted.
Thank you, sir. Sir has given us a very balanced approach that yes, there is no legislative provision as on date as regards implementation of the resolution plan, and also very rightly pointed out the fact that if this is such sort of an interpretation is made applicable, then probably it can open up a Pandora's box wherein all resolution applicants go up and say that no, in the present scenario, we are not willing to implement our obligations. So taking this further, I'll like to understand from Mr. Dheer that in this scenario, when I'm sure there are many resolution applicants who have this sort of a dilemma, as a council, what do you feel? What is the law which is there? Is there any law which can support a resolution applicant? And how does a resolution applicant go about it? Should he approach the COC as honorable member was suggesting, or should he approach the honorable adjudicating authority, or what is the recourse? What is the best way forward for such resolution applicants at all the three stages? Mr. Dheer?
Yeah, Varsha, let me just point out that when the resolution plans are being filed, they are often scrutinized by the RP and then placed before the and process advisors, and then they are placed before the COC. At the stage when COC approves them, a letter of intent is also issued for the resolution. And I have been party to many of these transactions. The real problem that we are facing is that when the resolution plans are being drafted and filed by the RAs, typically RAs like to put in what is called a force majeure clause. But the RPs are insisting that they will not allow any clause to be put in there which can result in the resolution applicant withdrawing his plan or modifying his plan in a manner which is lower than what he has offered in the first place. Now, that is a problem that many RAs are facing, and therefore we find that most resolution plans do not have adequate provisions for withdrawal or for reduction of the offer at the cost of their EOIs or performance guarantees being withdrawn. So that is one unfortunate event, but since the RPs are insisting upon it and they are not allowing resolution plans to be filed by putting proper stipulation and protections for RPs, now that's one problem that we are facing. The second issue is that the Supreme Court has had an occasion with respect to the withdrawal. Now, I'm not saying that it's a COVID situation, but in the case of Maharashtra Seamless versus Padmanabhan Venkatesh, the Supreme Court has said that the plans approved by the adjudicating authority cannot be withdrawn. Now, that is the provision of law. So the question of force majeure will come later, but if the plans have been approved, they can't be withdrawn. That's the mandate of the Supreme Court. The question of impossibility of performance has also been considered by the Supreme Court in many situations which may not relate to directly to COVID, but I'm talking in terms of past decisions which have been taken by the Supreme Court in the matter where possibly, let's assume, physical or literal impossibility is not there for performance of a contract, but it has become impractical and useless from the point of view of the purpose and object of the contract to implement the contract. So what the Supreme Court says is that if it is impractical and from the perspective of the purpose of the contract, it is becoming impractical to implement, then it should be treated as an impossibility. Having said that, the Supreme Court, again, in another matter, Energy Watchdog versus Central Electricity Regulatory Authority, has talked in terms of performance being impossible versus performance being onerous. If the performance is onerous, there is no protection that you will get. But if it becomes impossible, it is possible for you, for an RA, to approach the COC, or for that matter, if the plan has not yet been approved, adjudicating authority, or even if the plan has been approved, they can come back with an application to the adjudicating authority and try to see that it becomes practical and implementable, because the only other option to send the company into liquidation in these times where there is going to be hardly any resolution applicants, or for that matter, people who are willing to take up the cases from the liquidator, it will become very difficult and there will be a loss of value and erosion of value to the stakeholder. I feel that in these situations, the consideration of the entire issue must be sympathetically dealt with by the COC and the courts. Of course, Mr. Singh will have the last word when he faces a situation when somebody comes up before him. But sympathetic consideration is very, very important. And enforcing strictly the bids which have been made at a point of time when they were based on the basis of fundamentals and foundations and assumptions pre-COVID may not hold good at all. I mean, let us just talk in terms of hospitality. Somebody may have bid for a hospitality asset prior to the COVID, but now we realize that post-COVID, there's no hospitality. The hotels have stopped functioning. Even if they start functioning, they will function with a lot of restrictions. And even the tourists are unlikely to come. Travel per se is going to become very short. So the very foundation of their bid may have completely lost itself. I think it is necessary to deal with them sympathetically, because if we are going to treat and say that the resolution plan must be adhered to entirely in the manner in which it was bid, not only will the resolution plan fail and therefore the corporate debtor will go into liquidation, but at the same time the resolution applicant will lend himself to penal consequences and action under the IBC, which will further deteriorate the position of the RA. And therefore, it is not just the CD which will suffer, but the RA will also suffer the consequences. I may point out one very important issue. Even before the declaration of lockdown in India, the Ministry of Finance on 19th February 2020, that is lockdown started on 25th March, has come with a notification which says this is a case of a natural calamity and has said that the force measure can be invoked where considered appropriate. Therefore, going by the notification of the central government, I have no hesitation in saying that there will be a lot of cases which will come up before the courts for adjudication, and Mr. Singh will have to sit and decide in these matters on a case-to-case basis whether it is possible whether it is possible to give some sympathetic consideration and some relaxations and try to ensure that the COCs, the resolution applicants, can sit together to find a resolution and a solution rather than taking a very strict stand in these matters in the interest of all concerned. Insofar as the current litigation on force measure is concerned, there are two very relevant judgments, one from the Bombay High Court in the case of Standard Retail, where they say the lockdown cannot be the legal basis for termination of a contract. And also the Delhi High Court in the case of Halliburton, where they had initially given an interim stay against a performance guarantee, but later said that because the default had occurred prior to the commencement of the lockdown, the protection under force measure cannot be made available to them. So I think a balanced approach will have to be taken. Lastly, the question of the number of resolution applicants which has been reduced. I think one of the issues we'll have to look at is also the impact of 29A, because that is the first stage where a large number of resolution applicants were taken out of the equation by being declared as not as entities who cannot file resolution plans. And lastly, I would say that insofar as MSME is concerned, the government has said that they are going to modify and amend 248A. I think there is possibility, the government is certainly looking at the issue of how to bring more resolution applicants. And if MSME sector is unshackled from the provisions of 29A and a dispensation is given under 248A with respect to MSME sector for bringing in larger number of resolution applicants for the purpose of giving resolution plans, I think it may mitigate the whole problem and we may have a larger number of resolution plans coming, at least in the MSME sector. And of course, in very iconic cases, there are always resolution applicants.
Thank you, Mr. Dheer. So we got quite a few interesting insights on how the force measure clause, which can be considered by the court, the judiciary definitely shall go by what is the law of the land. And the law of the land is very clear, which says that force majeure has to be a part of our contractual arrangements. The contract shall be required to be relooked on a case-to-case basis to ascertain what is the position and to what extent a particular party can take the benefit of a force majeure clause. But however, insolvency regime in the present ecosystem shall have to be aligned to meet the requirements of the resolution applicants, the company, other stakeholders, with the intent that liquidation should be avoided to whatever maximum extent which is possible. And over the period of time, I'm assuming that all these issues will be before the courts and the courts will accordingly take a view on what is best possible approach for all concerned. So now moving ahead of all the COVID issue, the interpretation of the ordinance and things like that. So let us try to understand one particular provision of the IBC code, which is the Applicability of Limitation Act. Applicability of Limitation Act in a proceeding filed under Section 7, 9 and 10 has been a subject matter of intense debate. I can personally say one particular thing is that this is one of the provision of the code which actually engages us a lot, because certain parties are clearly as on date not entitled to invoke the provisions of Section 7 of the IBC. A lot of law has come, starting from the adjudicating authority to the Honorable Supreme Court of India, wherein the criteria for computation of the period of limitation has been deliberated upon and discussed by the Honorable Supreme Court. So on this particular issue, I'll first like to understand from Honorable Member Mr. V.P. Singh, so what is it that a particular creditor, more so a financial creditor, is required to prove once he is approaching the adjudicating authority under Section 7 petition? And how do you think that limitation is required to be calculated in matters wherein there is a date of default, which is prior to 3 years from the initiation of the petition? So if you can just enlighten us on this issue.
Regarding limitation, there is no change during pandemic. Has during for pandemic cases, the Honorable Supreme Court has given clear cut during pandemic from March 15 onward, limitation will be provided. This period will not be counted. So COVID will not have it will not affect the limitation. Anyhow, limitation law in IBC is concerned. It is all to be everything. See, IBC is a new code, and after introduction, see, there was a only skeleton, and after that, flash and everything is being saved. It is being saved every day from NCLT, NCLAT. Then after, it only everything is finalized by the Honorable Supreme Court, most of the cases. So, see, regarding limitation. Now it is a settled position. The Article 137 limitation will be 3 years as per Article 137, and BK educational case in that Supreme Court has Honorable Supreme Court has clearly laid. It is a leading case in which Honorable Supreme Court has clearly laid down the guideline, and this is Section 7, 9, and 10 cases. These are only applications, and under residuary power under Article 37 will deal with that and only 3 years. This is the law of land. Regarding surface, in so many cases, it was in Jignesh Shah case, in the R. Bhojwani case, Supreme Court has dealt with, and Honorable Supreme Court has said this. Then, if the surface proceeding is going on, nobody can get the benefit of that period. The proceeding was pending in surface and everything. Only exemption is suppose there is acknowledgement of debt. And if within 3 years there is acknowledgement of debt, then certainly for a period of limitation will start. And no, and there is nothing change in the other positions. It is Jignesha case, R. Bhojwani case, and then lastly Sagar Sharma case, and BK educational case are the, in all these cases, the Honorable Supreme Court has clearly held that for IBC cases, 3 years limitation is available as per Article 137. There is no doubt
here. Thank you, sir. Mr. Dheer, now I'd like to ask you, sir has explained to us that the only exception which is available under the Limitation Act is the concept of acknowledgement of debt. So how do you view this issue of acknowledgement of debt coming to the rescue of the creditors for initiating proceedings under the court?
Varsha, I think I may like to discuss this from a little deeper level, at a deeper level. Now, if you really see, IBC came into the picture because there was failure of the earlier regimes to help the creditors recover their dues. And there was a huge backlog of non-performing assets which was there in the system. And IBC, in some sense, was there to ameliorate the mischief that the defaulting borrowers were doing by utilizing the earlier regimes and delaying the payment of their dues. That is the basic object and purpose and the mischief which the this act wanted to prevent. Now, while 238 came into the picture from 6th of June 18, thereby saying that Limitation Act will apply to the IBC cases, even otherwise, even before this amendment, it was very clear that insofar as limitation is concerned, it must apply to IBC also. Now, when the limitation started being interpreted, as very rightly pointed out by Mr. Singh, starting with the BK education matter, the Gaurav Hargobind, Jignesh Shah, etc., what the court seemed to have interpreted is that this will not come, the limitation will not be reckoned in terms of Article 62 and 136 of the Limitation Act, but will be considered in terms of the residual provision, Article 137 of the Limitation Act. Now, in Article 62, in case there was a mortgage suit, in case there was a mortgage, then 12-year period was permissible for the purpose of the creditor to approach the courts for recovery of dues. In case of decree, 12 years was given under Article 136 for the purpose of enforcement of the decree. So adequate time was available to the creditors. And in fact, prior to promulgation of this enactment, very large number of cases have been pending in courts for very long. Unfortunately, the system that prevailed prior to the IBC was such that people took advantage, and there have been cases which have been pending for decades in the courts. And when people have, with proper due diligence, applied themselves to the process of law for the purpose of limitation to recover their dues, they were thwarted for years and years by the defaulting borrower, and that is the whole purpose of IBC coming into the picture. But since it was interpreted in the starting with BK Educational Services by the Supreme Court that Article 137 will apply, because it is not a question of right to sue, but it's a question of commencement from the date of default, for which there is no specific article or provision in the Limitation Act. Therefore, it came under the residual provision of Article 137. With respect, it may have been a narrow interpretation, completely missing the object of the IBC and the purpose of the promulgation. According to me, this particular aspect has not been looked at. I may point out that in the case of BK Educational Services, the Supreme Court had mentioned that Section 5 of the Limitation Act will apply, which means that if there was a discretion in the court, if sufficient cause was given for the purpose of saying that limitation, exclusion or extension of time will be permitted. But as the matter went before the Supreme Court in Gaurav, in Jignesh Shah, in the case of Bhojani or Sharma, which have been mentioned by the Honorable Member, it started becoming a little more stricter and rigid. And therefore, the only option which has now actually been left is Section 18, which says if there is an acknowledgement of debt prior to the completion of the limitation period, then to that extent, it will be available. Now, very interestingly, Section 14 of the Limitation Act says that in case, in a bona fide manner, a creditor has approached a court which does not have jurisdiction in the matter, or has wrongly or misled himself to filing a petition in some court which is not having the jurisdiction to try the suit, the period will be excluded. Now, you must look at it from the perspective that if he was wrong and he made a mistake in filing a petition before a court which did not have jurisdiction, he will get extension of time. But if he was in a proper manner prosecuting his proceedings in civil courts which had jurisdiction to deal with the matter, he will not get the protection and he will not be given the extension of time for limitation. There is one more avenue which is open, which is Section 22, which says the continuing breaches and torts. In case fresh period will start from the moment of time which breach occurs. Therefore, it is possible to say that there is a continuous breach, and therefore, even if the matter has been, the first default has gone under the limitation period of 3 years under 137, it is possible to say that it is a continuous breach and subsequent breaches will also extend the period of limitation. I must lastly on this point say that I think the Government of India must apply its mind very seriously to the issue. The intention of 238 could not have been to non-suit a very large section of the creditors by saying that you are falling outside the limitation. You may have filed before the DRT or before the SARFACE Act, you may have pursued the matters or have taken action under arbitration, because many NBFCs have arbitration clauses under their loan documentation. So it could not have been possibly the intention of the legislature to non-suit a very large section. Another section of creditors, which is the asset reconstruction companies, have also come under a big cloud because of this interpretation of limitation. Typically, ARCs are acquiring debts from secured creditors after a period of time during which the secured creditors have been taking effort to to recover the dues. So the secured creditors, banks and financial institutions may have filed before DRT, etc. After 2-3 years of having failed, or even longer periods having failed to recover their dues, they have sold their debts to ARCs, and unsuspecting ARCs who are operational from 2002 to 2016 have acquired these assets, but are now finding that the provisions of IBC are closed to them and they are not in a position to take advantage of IBC for the purpose of resolving or recovering their debts. Also, decrees which are under execution are being non-suited by saying that the proceedings in arbitration in IBC are for resolution and not recovery. Though, to my mind, and in my humble way, I would say that for a creditor, every resolution is actually a recovery. That's all that he's wanting out of a resolution, to recover his dues. So this phrase that IBC is for resolution, not recovery, insofar as a creditor is concerned, is completely meaningless, because all that he wants out of the resolution is recovery. He wants nothing else. So I would say that there is a need. The interpretation of the Supreme Court technically correct, but is that what was the intent of the legislation? The Government of India will have to see, and whether any relaxation or a modification or an amendment in the Act should be made to ensure that such large section of people is not non-suited, is something that the court will have, the government will have to decide. And till then, as Mr. Singh has very rightly pointed out, the sway of the Supreme Court, the decision of the Supreme Court in the matters which he has referred, will hold sway and will govern the creditors in this country.
Thank you, Mr. Deed. So,
Mr. Thiru, you have very rightly pointed out that in most of the cases, suppose in ARC cases, then debt is assigned, and after that, in so many cases, all are time bank cases, mostly they are after, if the ARC has purchased the debt, and after assignment, if it is, in most of the cases, we found that they are all are time bound, and it has a large impact on the economy. But anyhow, what is the law of the nation? Honorable Supreme Court has dealt with all these issues and has discussed the issue that the commercial, we cannot interpret in a way that it is a commercial transaction and everything. And the only thing is there is a difference in application and suit. And if the whatever the decree the, and for other things, suit limitation of 12 years, so the redemption of mortgage, there is 12 years limitation. But for a suit, not for this application. So everything is this, when it is settled by the Supreme Court, then certainly either government legislature can do anything or another Supreme Court can anything. But anyhow, it is the law of the nation and it is binding on all of us.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much.
I understand and stand corrected to that extent.
Thank you, sir. I think so. It has been very aptly put by the honorable member that what is the law of the land, and the fact that all of us are bound by law of the land, probably certain peculiar issues creating a concern with the creditors was the issues which were being highlighted by Mr. Dheer on what may or what might be certain missing limbs in the IBC provisions of the code. Moving ahead from creditors, financial creditors' right to initiate proceeding under Section 7 of the IBC, wherein 238A and Limitation Act is a very critical aspect, is another aspect of who is a financial creditor. It is only a financial creditor who can file a petition under Section 7 of the IBC. Now, recently, the Honorable Supreme Court came up with the judgment in the matter of JP. In this matter, the Honorable Supreme Court, while dealing with the issues of what is a preferential transaction, Section 43, essential criterions of Section 43, 45, also dealt with and elaborated upon the concept of a financial creditor and whether mortgagees can be considered as financial creditor or not. The reading of the judgment issues certain interesting aspects as regards who is a financial creditor and who can be considered a financial creditor. So I'd like to understand what is the take of our esteemed panel on this judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court, which has culminated all the earlier prior law of financial creditor. And now we have a very nicely, aptly put judgment, which talks about disbursement against consideration for time value of money as the key criteria for a creditor to be classified as a financial creditor. Honorable Member Mr. V.P. Singh, sir, I'll just request you to give us some of your meaningful insight on this judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court.
Yes, you have very rightly pointed out the situation which has been discussed in JP Infratech. In JP Infratech case, Honorable Supreme Court has held that secured, in that case, what has been discussed on the Honorable Supreme Court has held that mortgage being neither towards any loan facility or advance to the corporate debtor, nor towards protecting any facility or security of the corporate debtor, it can be said that the corporate debtor owes them any financial debt within the meaning of Section 5(8) of the Code, and hence the Supreme Court decided that lenders of JAL, JP Associates Limited, do not fall in the category of financial creditors of the corporate debtor. In this connection, Insolvency Law Committee report has also given there are two clauses, and they have given a report regarding this. There should be proper interpretation. But when the Honorable Supreme Court has given an interpretation, it has clearly said that they can be secured creditor, but they cannot be treated as a financial creditor of the corporate debtor. And that's why they have decided that JP Associates Limited cannot be treated as a financial creditor of the JP Infratech, but they can be secured financial creditor, secured creditor. And in this case, they have very, Honorable Supreme Court has very elaborately discussed the issue. The Supreme Court has said that mortgage which requires this financial debt under section is defined under section 5(8) of the code, which conspicuously omits mortgage and which required disbursement against the consideration for the time value of money as lead element. I said the respondent lenders of JP Associates Limited, by holding the mortgage in their hand, I said to have been executed the corporate debtor JP Infratech Limited, may be carrying a security interest and may be the creditor who may claim to be falling within the terminology secured creditor, yet cannot become financial creditor of the corporate debtor, JIL, who is owing any financial debt to him. So probably this issue has been decided by the Supreme Court anyhow, and the Insolvency Law Committee report is also there, only some interpretation is needed. The Supreme Court has given the interpretation and everybody has to follow. I don't think that the Supreme Court has clearly said that the guarantor, if the JAL has not, there is no loan has been granted to JIL, security. For the loan of the JAL, security mortgage has been created, and for that, he can be only treated as secured creditor, but can't be treated as financial creditor in the definition of 5(8) of the code.
Thank you so much, sir. Probably the lawyer in me will now direct a question to Mr. Dheer to understand that this particular interpretation of the Honorable Supreme Court, what is your view on how the guarantor shall be placed in the light of this judgment? Do you think there can be any change in position as regards guarantors not meeting the critical element of disbursement against consideration for time value of money to the corporate debtor?
Yeah, I think Mr. Singh has very rightly pointed out and explained the judgment in the case of JP and the implication and how the Supreme Court has distilled the issue of the interpretation of the word financial debt and financial credit. Rightly so, because I think Section 5, Subsection 8 starts with the word disbursed time value of money. Dispersal with respect to time value of money has therefore become the critical factor, and the Supreme Court has said that that overrides whatever are the sub-clauses of subsection 5(8). And subsection 5(8) says financial debt means a debt with, along with interest, interest, if any, which is disbursed against the consideration for time value. So that has become the primary phrase for the purpose of interpretation. In the case of guarantors, as you have very rightly pointed out, Varsha, and the lawyer view has rightly taken, because we will raise all sorts of issues and contentions which will then fall upon Mr. Singh and then finally the Supreme Court to decide. But the question is that a guarantor may well say that there is no time value of money. Okay, I have not taken any disbursal with respect to time value of money because no money has come into my bank account. And therefore may say that insofar as a petition under Section 7 is concerned, cannot be filed against me. That is one very peculiar, if I may say, aftermath or consequence of the interpretation that has been given by the Supreme Court. I'm not saying that will hold good or otherwise. A decision will have to be taken, and analysis will have to be done whether this will fall, a guarantor will fall under the mischief of 5 subsection 8 or not. But be that as it may, that is an interpretation which certainly some lawyers will raise. Now, secondly, not only guarantors, it's a question here of creation of security. Whether the creation of security is by a debt of a holding company into a subsidiary company or creation of security has happened in another context. It could be a systemic concern has given a security with respect to the debt. There could be many circumstances in which security are created third party against third party guarantee or third party mortgages. Now, the entities which have given third-party mortgages will not come under the definition of a financial debt under Section 5, Subsection 8. And it may be, again, unintended, but proceeding under Section 7 will not lie against them. Therefore, both third-party security mortgage creations and guarantees may fall out from the provision. The other implication that one will have to see is that when you are filing a claim, if it is not a financial debt, to what extent it may impact you while filing a financial claim is required to be seen. And in due course of time, I think these matters will come up for consideration before the courts. And I think at that stage, it will fall upon the judicial forums to take decision on this. But it is going to put a bit of a cat amongst the pigeons at the very least. And clever lawyers like you, Varsha, will try to exploit. And then Mr. Singh will be there to make sure that nobody is able to exploit the situation and the correct, meaningful interpretation holds sway.
Thank you, Mr. Dheer. Yes, this definitely gives me a lot of meaningful insight, and hearing both my esteemed panelists, I definitely have a lot of takeaways, at least as regards JP judgment is concerned. So now moving further, another issue which is a issue which has been creating some stir amongst specifically the resolution applicants, because I believe that whenever we talk about the code, we have to deal with the resolution applicants, because ultimately it's the resolution applicants who is taking over a company and meeting the object and purpose of the code, which is resolution of a company in financial distress. So the resolution applicant's concern over the period of time has been as regards the past offenses of a company, how the past offenses results in certain attachments, attachment of movable properties, attachment of immovable property, and this has created quite a lot of litigation right up to the Honorable Supreme Court. Now, the latest amendment which came before this ordinance of yesterday was insertion of Section 32A of the IBC. Section 32A of the IBC says that a resolution applicant shall be protected against any prior offences committed by the company, thereby ensuring that the resolution applicant shall be subsequently not non-suited of any of the property belonging to the company. So this is, in my view, a very relevant amendment, because prior to this amendment, even in matter of Bhushan, Monnet, we were seeing that the companies were going right up to the Supreme Court seeking annulment or release of attachment of assets by the enforcement directorate in that particular case. So this brings me to my next question that I'd like to place before my honorable panelists, is that 32A is now clearing the air, if I may use the word, and saying that everybody is protected and you cannot take any action against the prior attachment and all. But why is it that still all these interstate departments are going ahead with the attachment orders, and every time we have to knock at the door of the honorable adjudicating authority or the appellate tribunal to say that please look, this is something which is beyond the code and please protect us to that extent? I'll first like to take the view of honorable member Mr. VP Singh to understand, sir, what in his view can be a way out or a solution in this situation where the interstate government departments are repeatedly coming up with such attachment orders and unnecessarily maybe burdening the court, wherein the litigants have to approach the court.
Ms. Banerjee, you have pointed out regarding misuse of Section 30, abiding by the provision of Section 32A. Probably, if you are saying that so many government departments are not adhering to the law laid down by the Parliament, 32A is not being adhered. They are misusing the position. Even if cases are being filed. Certainly, 32A has been brought with a view, it is a motivator for resolution applicants. Otherwise, why? If any case company, if a resolution applicant gives and file an application and take the company and management is changed, certainly for the offense committed by the earlier corporate debtor who was the reason, who has caused this by the corporate debtor, then for which the new resolution, successful resolution applicant can't be held responsible. That's why the 32A has been incorporated, and it has given protection to the resolution applicants. They can give, otherwise if you are not implementing this, this provision would not have to come into force, then nobody will take interest in purchasing, in taking over the company. And the aims and objectives of the IBC is not liquidation. And successful, so many cases, see, suppose every case you can just say, every successful case, suppose you are saying that Ruchi Soya, before takeover, it was a case decided when I was adjudicating authority. The case was taken. Then first, it was nobody was taking. First bid was from other group, and that was 4,350 crore. He left the field and he said that I'm not abide by that, and he withdrew his plan before approval. He withdrew from that. Then Patanjali offered that on the same condition, I am ready to take over. If the Patanjali will get to know that if he will be responsible for the misconduct of the for the offences committed by earlier group, then certainly nobody will take over. And you cannot imagine this, that I saw a news item that this Patanjali share of Ruchi Soya share 3,600 times, increased 3,600 times from the takeover, after the takeover. So successful, so many successful resolution takes place. I know if for the misconduct of the earlier corporate data, if anybody held responsible, then nobody will take the company. To get a successful resolution plan, so it was an essential, and that's why government has brought this section through ordinance. It was much needed.
Thank you, sir. Yes, we have been fortunate enough that the adjudicating authority, quite a few matters handled by our esteemed panelist, honorable member, has actually helped the company to move forward, and the success story of Ruchi Soya is definitely which is known to all. And on this issue now, I'll just like to understand from Mr. Dhee, what in his view has been the approach or enthusiasm of the resolution applicants after insertion of this Section 32A? Does he feel it adequately protects the resolution applicants, and can they now be more protected in the scenario of having a statutory provision supporting them, Mr. Dheer?
I must again start by saying, sir, Mr. Singh, it must give you great satisfaction. To have passed orders.
Mr. Dheer, you are not audible.
Okay, I must start by saying that, sir, it must have given you great satisfaction to pass orders like in the case of Ruchi Soya and such other cases where the resolution plans have been finally successful. And I think Ruchi Soya is perhaps one of the cases where there is maximum wealth creation in post the restructuring plans. I congratulate you, sir. And I congratulate the nation for having
in this kind of legislation, and the impact of this legislation has and this provision has been felt, and value creation, value preservation and value creation is there. So I think rightly said, 32A was extremely necessary. There was a great deal of fear, and the risk was extremely high in case of resolution applicants, and they were fearful that in case they acquire businesses through the IBC route, and finally the likes of the CBI, SFIO, Enforcement Directorate and such other agencies are going to attach the assets, then they would be committing to pay for acquisition of businesses where none exists. So it was extremely essential. This issue came to fore in the case of JSW Steel versus Mahinder Kumar Khandelwal in Bhushan Power and Steel matter. And taking from there, the government has acted with great alacrity to come up with this particular amendment. And in fact, after this amendment, there is satisfaction and comfort in the minds of the resolution applicants while bidding for cases where either potentially there are proceedings going on, or there is likelihood of proceedings going on, show cause notices, etc. are there. I must also say that in a sense, 32A reflects on the hierarchy which is created under Section 53, which actually says that the dues of the government will be much below the dues of the secured creditors. So primacy has been given through 32A also to the same concept that in case the resolution applicant is giving a bid for an asset, he should be able to give it with comfort and satisfaction that the asset will remain in his hands and will not be snatched away. And the secured creditors are also benefited in as much as they will be able to derive higher value. Because if there are cases where there is a risk of this attachment, either there will be no resolution applicant at all, or a resolution applicant will be wanting to pay a very, very small amount to mitigate his risk. And therefore, 32A has come as a big support to the entire IBC process and provide comfort to the resolution applicants to come forward and bid. I feel that the section has been, at this point of time, fairly and properly worded. I do not see many people having any difficulty in making bids with this comfort in their hand. And of course, if there are other difficulties which will come, we will come across during the course of the proceedings in NCLT, there would be issues which will have to be looked at. But for the time being, I think Section 32A gives adequate comfort to resolution applicants to bid for assets in a fearless manner and to give the highest value for the assets, and the value to the stakeholders is preserved.
Thank you, Mr. Deep. So moving ahead from resolution, the second part or the next chapter in the IBC regime is the liquidation proceeding. Liquidation proceeding is itself a process in entirety and has been faced with many issues which are ongoing. Every time there is a new issue which comes up, it's itself a very challenging process. Liquidator has to form a liquidation estate. Liquidator thereafter has to advertise the estate. There is an option of going ahead with a 230 scheme of compromise arrangement in terms of Companies Act 2013. There is a provision of going ahead with sale as a going concern. Thereafter, there is an entire process of piecemeal sale of assets. Now, this liquidation proceedings itself poses great many queries and great many issues, both for the liquidator as well as the stakeholders. Let us now try understand some issues which are happening and arising in most of the cases. I'll first like to start with the issue of relinquishment of security. The IBC code interestingly says that a secured creditor has an option of relinquishing his security interest, wherein after he is free to take action again under the provisions of the other applicable law, that is principally the SARFAESI Act. But now this issue of relinquishment of security interest in cases where a company has a secured asset charged to multiple lenders poses lot many issues. there is different secured creditors taking different stands, secured creditors not taking up stand together, ultimately result in delaying the entire liquidation process. There has been some judgments and some view of the Honorable Adjudicating Authority as well as the Honorable Appellate Tribunal on the process and the option how the secured creditor can exercise their right on relinquishment of a security interest. So I want to first start with the issue of relinquishment of security interest and would request Honorable Member to please enlighten us and guide us on what is it that the secured creditor should go forward with, what is it that the liquidator can consider in such a scenario of a asset being secured and security of multiple lenders being there on the particular secured assets, and how that asset can be dealt under the IBC. Sir, if we can have your comments on this issue.
Yes. Yes, Ms. Banerjee, you have raised a very pertinent question. Government has brought Regulation 21A. Regarding presumption of security interest. 21A deals with that. And that if you have any secured creditor has not given its consent within 30 days, then there should be deemed consent. Prior to this, there was no such regulation. And what happened if a secured creditor does not give its consent, then the entire proceeding, because everything is to be in time, given in a timeline, how the liquidator can proceed with if the secured creditor has not given its option. Either he has not relinquished his security and he is not giving his consent also. That was the problem. But after bringing it 21A regulation, it provides that a secured creditor shall inform to the liquidator of his decision to relinquish his security interest to the creditor, security interest, to relinquish security interest. His decision to relinquish his security interest to the liquidator is liquidation estate or realize his security interest as the case may be in form C or D. Or within 30 days, if he doesn't give the consent, then it will be presumed that it will be deemed consent. Then the question now, there is no, if it is not, secured creditor has not given its consent, then there will be deemed consent and the liquidator can proceed with. So 21A has, with the concept of deemed relinquishment, there is no ambiguity in this provision, and it is a liquidation process, say it can be done in time-bound manner.
Thank you, sir. Now that sir has explained us the regulation 21A, which was inserted subsequently by the liquidation regulation amendment of 25th July 2019, I'd like to ask Mr. Dheer, in his practical experience, as also as an insolvency professional, what is his take on how easy or how difficult is it for all the stakeholders to come together and maybe now be guided by Regulation 21A and proceed in such matters of liquidation proceedings, Mr. Deep?
You are not audible.
Hello.
Hello.
Can you hear me better, Varsha?
Sir, Mr. Deep, you are not audible. If you.
Hello. Is it better?
Yeah. Yes. Please go ahead, Mr. Deep.
Varsha, I think Mr. Singh has explained the provision of 21A and the purpose and basis for which this provision was put into the statute book in great detail. I think he has also very rightly pointed out that prior to the amendment, prior to this regulation being brought onto the statute book, I mean, in the sense it's a regulation, there was a lot of confusion with respect to relinquishment of charges. And there were, obviously, we are living in a country where there is multiple security creation and multiple lenders. And if somebody was not relinquishing his charge, the entire liquidation process was going for a six, and recovery of monies in liquidation was being jeopardized. I think the government has done very well to bring in this particular regulation for the purpose of clarifying the issue that in case the secured lender wants to retain the charge and wants to recover the dues by sale of the assets on his own, then he is under Section 52. He is required within 30 days to bring to the notice of the liquidator that he is wanting to realize his security. Otherwise, it will be a deemed relinquishment. Now, there are three stipulations in 21A, and I think it goes on to explain it a little more and how it is being made more practical. So the first instance is within 30 days, whether to relinquish or to decide to realize his charge is the first thing. After that, within 90 days, the secured creditor who is wanting to realize the security is requiring to pay the proportionate amount due under the CIRP cost and the liquidation cost. So the liquidator has to give the details of the CIRP cost and the estimated liquidation cost. And a person who's wanting to realize the security on his own within 90 days has to pay his share. The purpose for this is that he should not be willing to take up this right in a very casual or cavalier manner. There is a cost that he has to bear, and he has to ensure that he pays the cost before he takes this opportunity for himself. The next stipulation is that in case thereafter, within 180 days, he has to pay the money. So another timeline is put in place that after that, within 180 days, he has to resolve, recover the money, and then whatever is the balance amount which is payable to the liquidator has to be paid by him. In case these three stipulations are not fulfilled, then the asset, even though the creditor may have a charge on this asset, will come within the liquidation estate and will come within the powers of the liquidator for applying the process of liquidation. And as Varsha, you mentioned, obviously now the process is that first he has to sell as a going under 230 of the Companies Act as a going concern, and then perhaps splice and sell of these assets. So this whole process has now been clarified. The only hitch in my mind is that there is a notification which says that 21A will apply only prospectively, in the sense that cases which are coming under liquidation, which liquidation has been, order has been passed prior to 25th of July 2019, will not get the benefit of Regulation 21A. To my mind, that's a matter of some concern. And however, I have seen that where the committees which have been created of the creditors who have been giving advice to the liquidator, where these committees are coming forward and have been requesting that the provisions of 21A be applied, the adjudicating authorities have, despite the fact that 21A is applicable only prospectively, for the purpose of transparency and for the purpose of efficacy in recovering dues, the adjudicating authorities, at the request of the liquidator or the committee of creditors, has been allowing the process under 21A to be followed, and so that the majority view of the creditors is holding sway and they are able to resolve the matters in a more time-bound manner, and effectively liquidation process can be put in place.
Thank you, Mr. Deer. Yes, I do believe that holistically applying a particular regulation, whether even in pending matters initiated prior to 25th July 2019, is the way ahead, and all stakeholders, liquidators, and even the adjudicating authority is conscious of this particular fact and accordingly proceeding with the matters. Now, liquidation fundamentally also has a very specific issue to my mind. That is that the code, the Suez Ribbon, which was being quoted by Mr. Dheer earlier during this webinar, says that resolution is the principal object and purpose of the code. So in light of the main focus of the IBC being driven toward resolution of the company, what is it that now the amended Section 33 seeks to achieve? The amendment which I am talking about here is the amendment which says the committee of creditors at any stage can resolve that the company should be sent to liquidation instead of waiting for the statutory period of 180 days, which was earlier being, in fact, in many matters also insisted upon by the adjudicating authority that please follow this period of 180 days to see whether any resolution is possible or not, and thereafter only send a company for a liquidation process. So now this amendment to Section 33, which says that, okay, maybe probably in the first meeting of COC also, the COC can resolve to send a company to liquidation. Is this in line with the object and purpose of the code? If I may ask Honorable Member Mr. VP Singh, that this particular amendment of Section 33, was it necessary in the context of IBC, or this only came as a matter of clarification, or what is it that this amendment to 33 seeks to achieve? Sir, if you may please address us.
Yes, Ms. Banerjee. What is the object of the resolution? IBC, resolution. If the company is not having any property, company is not viable, company doesn't have any business, then what is the use of keep it pending? There can't be a resolution. Then liquidation is the only solution. If you are, you have to wait for 180 days and company doesn't have any property, then the company, each of the resolution professional and everything, so many cost resolution, a CIRP cost, who will pay that? Company is not having any property. Then it is also a resolution. There are no chances. Really, there are no need of going to wait 180 days. This amendment is very good. And I think that it is also a type of resolution. Then a business which is not viable can only be liquidated. And that's why if the committee of creditors decided it to liquidate, it is a good step the government has taken this amendment to expedite the case, but to save the cost of CIRP cost and unnecessary burden the financial creditors.
Thank you, sir. I think sir has in a very crisp manner said that actually liquidation is also a mechanism of resolution. So can I have a quick take of Mr. Dheer on whether he also views liquidation as a mechanism of resolution only?
See, firstly, the Supreme Court in the case of Swiss Ribbons has defined resolution as the primary objective of the IBC. Now, there are many issues. I mean, this is, of course, the interpretation of the law. There are various issues, and at the point of time when the IBC was being put in play, and in fact, the Vishwanath Committee was there, there was thought of a seamless transfer between a resolution process and a liquidation process. The importance of liquidation was highlighted in the Vishwanath Committee report. And the intent was to say that it must be very quick, very smooth, and it must be seamless. So in some sense, when one had gone through the Vishwanath Committee report, one had realized that they are talking in terms of importance being given both to resolution and liquidation, because ultimately it was a question of timeliness and recovery of the money in the interest of the stakeholders. But over time, and as the interpretation of the enactment has gone and the Supreme Court has decided in the case of Swiss Ribbon, I think we must take it as a principle that resolving the assets is far more important. But coming back to this question of amendment to Section 33, I entirely agree with Mr. Singh's interpretation that it has been a very useful amendment, wasteful time and energy of resolution applicants and creditors, and throwing good money after bad in conducting a CIRP process in case where there is no viable asset of the company and resolution is not likely to result in any benefit for the society and the stakeholder, for the stakeholders and the society at large, then it is best to nip the whole thing in the bud and close the process so that the time of everybody is safe and no money and time is wasted in running after cases where resolution is not possible. I think it is completely dovetailed within the concept of overriding right of resolution versus liquidation. It is only redefining it to say that something which is completely not capable of being resolved must be liquidated quickly.
Thank you, Mr. Dheer. I think so. We should be mindful of the fact and go by the saying that we should not throw any good money behind bad money, as has been brought to our notice by my panelists. So before I move to the Q&A round, I'll just take one last question on the issue of liquidation, and then we'll move to the Q&A round. is one particular aspect which I feel is somehow troubling people under the code is the aspect of change of liquidator. So the code is completely silent on the process of change of liquidator. Liquidator, once appointed under the code, remains as a liquidator. As for a resolution applicant is concerned, there is a process. The code gives us a power, a mechanism of changing a resolution professional. However, in case of a liquidator, there is absolutely no provision to my mind which says that this is how a liquidator can be changed. So I'd like to put this question first to Mr. Dhir to understand, as a lawyer, as a counsel, if a person comes to him and says that he wants to change the liquidator, what is the provision under the code, or whether there is any provision under the code which can facilitate such a request of maybe the stakeholders committee, Mr. Dhir?
Varsha, very rightly pointed out by you, there is no specific provision under the law for change or replacement of a liquidator. I think this was conceptually done in a way. At the CIRP stage, there is a committee of creditors, and the decision of the creditors with respect to the resolution of the company was paramount. So they were responsible for deciding. Once they have come to a stage where the committee of creditors have decided in their mind that it is not possible to resolve the company, the interest has shifted from the committee of creditors to the stakeholders at large. So it is not necessary at that stage to look after the interest of just the committee of creditors, who are principally financial creditors, but the liquidator has to take a more holistic picture with respect to all stakeholders, and he has to balance the interests of all the stakeholders. And therefore, the initiative has shifted from the committee of creditors to the liquidator. And therefore, the person who is entitled to keep a liquidator or change a liquidator cannot be the committee of creditors anymore. That is the conceptual shift that has taken place from transferring a case from the CIRP process to the liquidation process. Having said that, the secured creditors continue to be the most important stakeholders. If we apply the provisions of Section 53, they are in turn the stakeholders where in the hierarchy who have to be paid the amount first. And therefore, besides looking at it from a purely conceptual issue, on a very practical plane, clearly the secured creditors must have to have a say. Now, there are problems which we are facing: incapacity of the liquidator, death of a liquidator, or such circumstances where they find that it is not possible for the liquidator to perform his role independently, or there are any concerns in the minds of the creditors with respect to a liquidator, then an option ought to have been built in, of course, subject to the adjudicating authority accepting the fact that the liquidator needs to be replaced, and the secured creditors to have some say in the process of change of liquidator. I must point out that there is absolutely no difficulty at all for an adjudicating authority, or for that matter an appellate authority, in peculiar facts and circumstances of the case to decide that the liquidator needs to be changed, and the matter can go to the IBBI also for the purpose of identifying a liquidator from the list of liquidators that is being maintained for this purpose. The issue which is for consideration is, should the creditors, secured creditors, financial creditors, the COC, have any right or to change? Now, as we know that once the liquidation process starts, the creditors, the liquidator will form a committee that can only give advisory. They have no right to direct the liquidator to do it in any way or the other, but it is possible for such a committee, for good reason, to request for change of the liquidator and then approach the adjudicating authority, and I'm sure they will be considering this aspect. I'm aware of one particular case called Alchemist ARC versus Vijit MEDC, where one of the financial creditors had approached the NCLT for under Section 60 bracket 5C for change of liquidator for some reasons given there. But to the best of my understanding, that case was subsequently withdrawn. And therefore, the issue whether the secured creditors, financial creditors, will have any right or not is open. Under the current dispensation of law, there is no provision for them to enforce the change of a liquidator of their choice.
Thank you, Mr. Dhir. Now that Mr. Dhir has explained us that there is no principal statutory provision under which the liquidator can be changed. He has rightly pointed out that the adjudicating authority has been considerate of these issues. And therefore, I'll just like to understand from Honorable Member Mr. V.P. Singh that, sir, in your experience or as a practical approach, do you feel that in case the stakeholders committee approach the adjudicating authority with such a request for change of liquidator in peculiar backgrounds, maybe death of the liquidator or maybe some other situation where the stakeholders somehow lose confidence in the liquidator, the adjudicating authority shall rise to the occasion and address the issue?
Yes, Ms. Bhagandi, I would like to point out, see, there is, I admit that there is no provision, specific provision in the code, but adjudicating authority has the, so many, there may be so many circumstances for which no provision is there, but adjudicating authority is there. Every case has a specific problem. So maybe a different type of problem and it has to be dealt with by the adjudicating authority. So many things are there, are not, it is not mentioned in the code. But if the things are pointed out to the, brought before the adjudicating authority, orders are being passed. And after that, in so many cases, liquidator has been changed. Suppose there is a serious complaint against the liquidator. Certainly, adjudicating authority can replace the liquidator. There is no bar on that. Adjudicating authority has full right to that. Mr. Dheeraj pointed out that IBBI can also change, but I don't agree with this. IBBI cannot change the liquidator if the adjudicating authority asks for the name of the liquidator from the IBBI, then IBBI can recommend the name of the liquidator. But it is a totally a judicial decision of the adjudicating authority. And if no name is recommended, committee of directors has not passed any, suppose earlier resolution professional has refused to work as liquidator, then certainly nobody can compel the resolution professional to work as liquidator. Then in that case, adjudicating authority had discretion to appoint liquidator. And often it is, in so many cases it happens. Suppose company has no funds. No liquidator wants to remain liquid. If anybody is appointed a liquidator, nobody wants if the company don't have any fund. Nobody wants to take the charge of the liquidator. In such circumstances, the adjudicating authority used to appoint, it is normal court used to appoint a liquidator, and then there is no bar on that, and he is full of right for that.
Thank you, sir. I think sir has summarized the entire issue and said that yes, in our experience, the adjudicating authority has in many matters exercised power and ensured that due justice is being rendered, whether it is change of liquidator, whether it is change of RP, whether in cases of deadlock, which also we have seen a lot, the adjudicating authority while exercising powers being the judicial authority under the code has tried to iron out the creases which were there in implementing the provisions of the IBC code. So now I'll go to the questions which have been addressed by the participants to the webinar. And the first question I'll like to put it to Mr. Dheer, because it is basically the participants' view. Participants wants to understand how shall be this increased threshold be made applicable by the adjudicating authority, as in whether this amount of 1 crore shall be made applicable even in the pending matters, or it is only the future matters in which the default threshold of 1 crore shall be made applicable. Mr. Dheer, if you can just address this issue, as this is a query of lot many participants.
Varsha, this has already come up for consideration by the Honorable NCLT in FESCO matter. I think it was NCLT Calcutta, which has taken a view that this threshold has to be looked at only prospectively. So any of the cases which have been filed prior to the amendment having come on the book will be covered by the old threshold of 1 lakh. And only after this particular amendment has come will the, this notification, in fact, it's not an amendment, it's a notification to Section 4. After this notification has come, only the cases filed subsequent to that will be covered by the new threshold. That is the view that has been taken. However, it's a matter which is yet to fall for consideration before a larger judicial platform. And ultimately, I think we should get a sense of what Mr. Singh is going to consider, because what he says will hold sway rather than this one single judgment of the NCLT.
Honorable Member, Mr. VP Singh, if I can also request you for your quick take. I understand that you are not before the tribunal as on date, but just for some guidance. So we are trying to understand some things from sir. So that's just a special request.
NCLT Calcutta has decided the issue. Certainly it will be before the NCLT, and then the bench will take a decision. It is a matter. See, it is, suppose it is of 1,50,000 rupees. And it is filed earlier than that. And what will be the position? It must be seen. Calcutta High Court has, Calcutta NCLT has given the judgment, and certainly the NCLT bench will decide the matter.
I understand.
It's not appropriate to see to give any opinion.
I understand, sir. And therefore, yes. I will, while exercising my discretion, direct the next question also to Mr. Dheer, because this is also as regards interpretation. And I believe Honorable Member is just trying to ensure that there is no message which is going at large at this point of time. So coming back to you, Mr. Dheer, is the applicability of Regulation 40C. This period, in terms of Regulation 40C, the period of lockdown has been extended for computation of period of limitation for both CIRP process as well as liquidation process. But with effect from 1st of June, what we are witnessing is the phase of Unlock 1. So what is your take? Unlock 1, whether this is also included within this exemption period, or now the timelines have started continuing?
See, from a very strict interpretation of Regulation 40C, it did mention the lockdown period. Now this unlock, because these terminologies are not part of any statute. The lockdown was imposed by the government from 25th March. The unlock period has started from 1st of June. That's unlock one is what they call it. So still there is a lot of difficulty in people either being able to manage the things, work from home. In fact, in NCR, Delhi NCR, we are seeing that there is all the three governments, UP, Haryana and Delhi, have at will been sealing the borders and unsealing the borders. So the real purpose of 40C was that during this period where there is difficulty or impossibility of conducting the matters under liquidation, the timeline should not run. I think finally it will fall to the discretion of the NCLT post 1st June whether this period would be covered under 40C or will be treated as exclusion period for the purpose of conduct of the CIRP or the liquidation, as the case may be, because that discretion lies with the adjudicating authority and the appellate forums. Now that 330 days is not supposed to be written in stone, and the Supreme Court says that it is not binding. So there is flexibility which is available. Certainly up to 1st of June, there is no doubt that it will be excluded. Beyond that, I would imagine to a certain extent, it will be a discretion which the authorities will have to apply.
Thank you, Mr. Dheer. So I'll just like to understand one thing from Honorable Member Mr. VP Singh is yesterday's amendment ordinance only, sir, because this has created a lot of stir in all our minds. And I just wanted to understand one issue which is coming in that ordinance is that the ordinance also suspends the initiation of proceedings under Section 10 of the IBC. So Section 10 of the IBC is principally a recourse available to a company to itself move the adjudicating authority under the IBC and say that this company is probably a fit company which should go into resolution as on date. So in this background of COVID-19 and ongoing pandemic, do you feel that corporate debtors should have been kept out of this particular amendment? So that if they feel that there is no scope as on date, they can seek a timely resolution, which is also the object of the court?
Probably, as far as Section 10 is concerned, because so there is suspension of Section 7 as per ordinance. There is suspension of Section 7, 9, and 10. But if Section 10, the corporate applicant itself, in this pandemic situation may occur where the company, due to pandemic, and business, certainly in such circumstances, situation may occur where the company has to move the application. But sir, this government may consider this thing. It requires reconsideration. Because 10 is the, there is no bar. If a company fails on account of pandemic, then certainly it has a right. And during pandemic, during this period, no. But during this period, no action can be taken. Just after 1 year, the company can move. This is the no action can be taken. There is suspension.
Thank you, sir. So related with this question only is a question of Mr. Manoj Surekha, which I'll now ask Mr. Dheer. This is in continuation to the query as regards suspension of Section 10. Mr. Dheer, in your opinion, do you feel is it better for a company to directly go for a Section 10 petition in case it has a default, which is for a debt which has become due and payable prior to 25th of March 2020? Instead of waiting for banks or some other operational creditors to take such creditor to the IBC code?
Thanks, Varsha. I think Mr. Surekha has raised a very important question. The first issue here is that even prior to the ordinance, there has been a lot of debate whether Section 10 should also be covered, because the Honorable Finance Minister in February only had said that she is going to come up with an ordinance. And there was a ongoing debate whether 7 and 9 should be suspended or 10 should also be suspended. I think larger minds have applied themselves to the process and decided that it should be Section 7, 9 and 10. I think the principle here is the question of misuse. Section 10 has, it is also possible, if you recall, that in the cases under SICA, the filings were being done by the corporate debtors themselves. And to a certain extent, because they to enjoy the moratorium, there was a use. And you are aware that in MSME cases, Section 29A does not apply. So it was possible for some people to steal a march by utilizing the provisions of Section 10 if they were not suspended, going through the MSME cases or smaller cases, going through the process and taking undue advantage, because the valuations of the assets have come down very significantly and the creditors would have been at the mercy of such people, because they would have had no choice but to decide on these matters on the basis of the valuations which have been obtained. So that's one issue. The second aspect I wanted to point out is that this ordinance only covers defaults from 25th March. So in case there is a corporate debtor and he is talking in terms of filing a Section 10 petition with respect to a default which has occurred prior to 25th of March, then there is no bar under the ordinance and under Section 10A for them to exercise their right and file a petition under Section 10 before the Honorable adjudicating.
Thank you, Mr. Deep. Mr. Himanshu Gandhi has raised a question, and I'd like to request Honorable Member VP Singh to just answer this question. Is that, sir, in your view, do you think this IBC amendment ordinance, which has come up yesterday only, is sufficient with dealing with the economic slump or slowdown which has been caused in India and, in fact, world over?
Yes, it is sufficient, because the government has given it, after due consideration, government has brought this ordinance. See, the declaration was there by Honorable Finance Minister about 15 days back, but after giving it, it was prior to this, there was a thinking that there will be general blanket, but Finance Minister itself made a speech that there can't be a general blanket, because ease of doing, government has everything in mind that the ease of doing business by India, and they don't want to totally scrap this IBC. That's why they have not given a blanket ban on that, and they have only considered that if the default is committed after 25th March. Otherwise, they should have given the provision of Section 7, 9, and 10 will remain suspended for 1 year. But by giving or relating it with the default means government want that all pending cases should be decided. There will not be ban on that. If the threshold limit is even if threshold limit is more than 1 lakh rupees, then they were 1 crore rupees, then certainly petition can be filed during this period. No, there is no ban on that. After all consideration, government has brought this amendment. I don't think that there is any flaw in this. But in my opinion, regarding Section 10, I have my personal experience. Section 10 is most widely misused. I have, as adjudicating authority, when I work as adjudicating authority, I have experience in so many places. Suppose a company has dues of has got the income tax notice, dues of 40 crore of income tax or 60 crore of excise duty and everything. Then they made a plan how to, then they make a plan, there was an inter-corporate agreement and they make a plan ABC, yes, the other file the application, I don't have any property and I want to file an application, Section 10 application is in file. Financial care committee of creditors consists of the same person, same group of person. They say that I don't have any objection, I don't, and then petition may be admitted immediately just after admission. They move that just to liquidation may be done. If the entire process is completed, then nobody can raise a demand.
So I understand.
Section 10 has been most widely misused. And I think that every authority should be very cautious in accepting this proposal. In one of the cases, I have seen that Section 10 was moved, entire process was made only with the for taxes, but after admission and so many process, then he said that why this petition was wrongly admitted when he himself had filed the petition. Then he raised the issue that it was wrongly admitted.
I understand, sir. Maybe our past experiences and some ingenious method utilized by some applicants in a Section 10 petition has made us more cautious. There are a lot many questions, and since we are running short of time, I'll like to close this session and thank my esteemed panelists for giving us time and addressing the various issues which were raised by all the participants. To the participants whose queries were not answered, we shall respond to you separately offline, and all the issues which were raised by the participants shall be duly closed at our end. And it has indeed been a very learning experience for all of us to have our esteemed panelists who have given us a very balanced approach with some contradicting different vision of what IBC shall be post COVID-19 era, of what we should look forward to, of the issues which will come up sooner or later before the adjudicating authorities. There is still a cloud as to what the creditors can do as on date if IBC is suspended for a period of 6 months for the time being, which can be extended also in terms of the ordinance. We have to see and analyze on each matter, on each basis, to see that what is it that was the best possible requirement of the company. And I am sure the adjudicating authority and we as councils shall have to apply ourselves on a daily basis to understand and streamline this applicability of the code and the amended code, more to say, in the present background. I again say a very thank you to all my participants and to my panelists. Thank you, Honorable Member Mr. VP Singh. Thank you so much, sir, for sparing out time for us. Thank you, Mr. Dheer, for being a part of the panel discussion and enlightening us. Thank you all.
Thank you, Varsha, and thank you, Mr. Singh. It's been a privilege to share the platform with you, sir. And we learned, even as a panelist, I learned so much from you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Dheer. Thank you, Ms. Banerjee. Certainly, it was an opportunity to me to address on the most critical issue because all these matters may come before us.
Thank you so much. Thank you all.
Thank you.